We just submit our wills to your will on this evening, Father. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for all that has transpired throughout this day. And we honor and reverence you for this very moment in time. Lord, we give you the praise, honor, and glory, God, for you still reign supreme. You're still on the throne, and all power is still in your hands. So on this evening, Lord, despite all of the challenges and difficulties, all of the attacks of the adversary, God, we continue to claim, Father God, that we have power in the name of Jesus. We continue to plead the blood of Jesus over our mind, over the mind of our spouses, our children, God, all of our youth, all of the workers in the school, Father God, even our essential workers in the hospitals, Father God, and all over this great city, state, nation, Father God. We just intercede for a moment and we lift them up and we plead the blood of Jesus for those that still have to be placed in dangerous environments and atmospheres and in dangerous arenas, Father God. God, even though they may be coming up against the COVID-19 pandemic, God, we know that there is more power in the blood of Jesus than there is in this pandemic. But God, we ask that you would just continue to impart your wisdom upon each of us at this time, Father God. Lord, let us not be ignorant, Father. Let us not be ignorant of the enemy's devices, God. Ignorance is a device of the enemy. So God, we break ignorance right now where many are suffering and many are endangering others and putting other people at risk. We break the back of ignorance right now in the name of Jesus, and we loose the spirit of wisdom and knowledge and understanding, Father God. God, we love you on this evening, and we give you praise, honor, and glory for those who will be tuning in tonight. Lord, those that are pressing their way into this hour of power even now, we decree safety upon them in the name of Jesus. We decree that everyone will arrive home safe, Father God, with an eager expectation to tune in on tonight, to just incline their ears to hear what you have to say on this evening, God. So we pray blessing upon our senior leadership, Apostle Charlie, God, our family, the campus pastors, Ray and Danette, and their family, God. We thank you, Lord, for how we continue to just surrender ourselves to you, to be used of you in great and mighty ways. We thank God for those leaders you have placed under our care here in this New Testament church, the new era, God, where we have returned back to the original, God. So we surrender our hearts to you, and we love you. We honor you. We bless you. We plead the blood of Jesus, God, divine safety, provision, peace, and power over every leader that is connected to us. In the name of Jesus, we decree and declare that the anointing flows from the head down. So God, the same grace, the same faith, the same anointing that the Ammons and the Millers walk in, God, under your grace, under your mercy, and under your favor, God, let that same anointing flow down to the beard of leadership of RCC, God, those who have connected with us through discipleship, those who have connected with us even recently just through fellowship, God, let your grace and your anointing, your faith and your favor rest, rule, and be with each of us in Jesus' name, and we all say amen. Well, glory to God, saints. And good evening and welcome to our Hour of Power. I'm Prophet Vicki Ammons, and on behalf of Apostle Charlie, myself, and Campus Pastors Ray and Danette Miller, good evening. It is our prayer, and we trust God that you have made it home safely and you have tuned in. And we invite you to participate in the chat room. Things that you may want to share that you may not be able to reach out immediately to share, just chat it. We'll go back in the chat room. We'll contact you, address anything that needs to be addressed. But we bless God for you joining us this evening via Internet Church for our Hour of Power. Praise the Lord. Somebody just shout or chat, praise the Lord with me. Let me know you are there. I don't like you leaving me hanging, so let me know that I am talking to you and that your ears are attentive to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying on tonight. So tonight I'm going to be continuing from the teaching series entitled The Secret Place. Sunday was an awesome time in the presence of the Lord, and I personally want to just real quick thank each of you for just allowing Holy Spirit to speak to you and to speak through you. For truly, we do not allow the anointing to stop at the top. It does not stop at the top. This anointing, according to Psalm 133, it falls from the head to the beard right on down. And so thank you for letting the Spirit of the Lord speak to you and then opening up your mouth in boldness to proclaim what thus saith the Lord. This is part of the New Era Church, the New Testament Church that we're a part of. So on Sunday, we confirmed that it is not God's will for us to come off of 10 days of prayer and consecration and then return to being heavy and bogged down. But rather, it is the Lord's will for us to remain in this secret place with Him. Right there, somebody ought to chat, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, saints. Praise the Lord. So when we refer to this secret place, we're talking about a secret place of sacrifice where, you know, we do what we need to do to press into and patiently wait for God. I said it, patient. Patience is part of the fruit of the Spirit. And when we don't have it, when we don't have it, saints, we miss God. We rush God, we miss God. And so patiently waiting for God in this secret place of sacrifice, a secret place indicative of a fasted lifestyle. You all know, if the truth be told, this is not the first year you have heard me coin the phrase a lifestyle of fasting or a fasted lifestyle. It should be our way of life. It should not be where 10 days are over and on day 11 we go back to consuming all of the unhealthy meats, grease, and sweets that don't do our body any good. And so it's a secret place that's indicative of a fasted lifestyle. We're talking about a secret place where we're light in our spirit and extremely sensitive to hearing the voice of God. We can only hear the voice of God at the drop of a dime when we are in this secret place. We know that God speaks in so many different ways that if we're not sensitive, once again, we will miss what God is saying. People say, is God speaking? God's always speaking. We're just, many are not inclined to hear what He's saying. Is God moving? God's always moving, but many of us are just not sensitive enough to what? See the move of God. Do you see the move of God coming from these 10 days of prayer and consecration right into a continuation where we abide, which means to what? Remain in the presence of the Lord, remaining in our secret place. So God speaks directly. He speaks indirectly. You know, God can speak through people. If He did it in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, what makes us think that God is not speaking through people today? So I would just dare to remind you in the spirit of this moment, don't miss God speaking to you through people you love, through people you hate. I'm not going to say hate, y'all, but you know what I mean. Can He speak through your enemies? Honey, let me tell you something. God can speak through anybody, anytime He chooses to speak. So just make sure you have an ear to hear. I love the way God speaks to us or me through nature. I remember the other day I was sitting on the water, and I'm going to just tell you, I need to hear from the Lord. I didn't open up my Bible. I didn't open up the internet. I went to the water. You hear what I'm saying? I went to the place of being refreshed. And in this place, I remember the Lord spoke to me and He shared with me, why is it that the enemy is just, you know, constantly trying to frustrate the grace that is upon my life? And He showed and He spoke to me through the water. He showed me how when anything touches the water, it generates a ripple effect. It generates a ripple effect. So there were ducks in the water, and every time a duck placed his feet in the water, it would produce a ripple effect. And God spoke to me on the water. He said, that's how I am. God says, when I touch you, PV, when I touch you, Vicky, the enemy is so on you because when I touch you, there's a ripple effect and it impacts whatever he touches, whatever he does, whatever he speaks to me. He knows I'm going to speak it to someone else and it's going to cause a ripple effect. And I just saw that ripple effect in the waves and it was just ongoing. And he just spoke to me to be at peace. That's why the enemy's frustrating you, because of the impact that you make. When I touch you, he knows you're going to touch others. And so glory to God. You got to be sensitive, and it's a continuation of remaining sensitive to what God is saying. So I'm talking about a secret place where all of our spirits are light and extremely sensitive to the voice of God. Amen. So flowing in the spirit from Sunday, dealing with a new era. We talked about shaking and breaking the old. Now, this is a difficult thing for a lot of us to be able to wrap our mind around. You can't wrap your mind around shaking and breaking the old, okay? You gotta wrap your heart around it, and then you gotta transform your mind to line up with the Spirit of God. We're talking about shaking and breaking old ways. What are some old ways that you were engaged in prior to the consecration and the time of prayer? Breaking and shaking old mindsets, breaking and shaking old tendencies. And we're talking about embracing and appreciating the new. Somebody chat with me, appreciating the new. Amen. God is doing a new thing, and we know that. And so all that falls under the characteristics of a New Testament church, we want to embrace and we want to appreciate. Amen. So your homework tonight is to check your e-blast and rehearse the instructions that Apostle Charlie gave us on day 10 of our prayer and consecration. If you did not receive it, email info@rccva.church and ask them to forward the link to you. You're gonna be lost and stuck in the old if you do not tap into the spirit of the new era that God has called us to. Why don't you chat? I will not be left behind. I will not be left behind. Saints, I want to encourage you in the spirit of the Lord. Don't listen to a word one time and think you got it. Don't listen to it one time and think I have arrived. It's an ongoing. We're talking about abiding, remaining in this secret place with the Lord. Rehearse the word while you're walking, while you're cooking, while you're doing dishes, while you're doing laundry, while you're cutting grass. I want to speak this into your spirit, because Holy Spirit is just showing me there's been too much slothfulness and laziness and just non-compliance, you know, with what it is that he is speaking to each of us through his prophets. And so there comes a time where you can either yield and surrender voluntarily, or Holy Spirit will arrest you and you will yield and surrender involuntarily. I don't know about you, but I don't want to have to be forced to yield to the instructions that have been given to me in this new era. Hallelujah. I want to voluntarily yield and submit. How about you? Voluntarily or involuntarily? Because God is going to do what he needs to do, whether you voluntarily submit and yield to his will or not. Somebody chat with me. God's will shall be done. Yes, it will. In the earth realm, God's will shall be done. So grab your notepads. Amen. Grab your notepads. I'm going to give you a few moments. Grab your notepads and purpose your heart to rehearse even the word on tonight at least one more time. Amen. So in the secret place, is a place where, according to Matthew 7:7, I'm not backtracking to Sunday. I'm moving forward. Amen. But even when we look at Matthew 7:7, the word of the Lord says, ask and it will be given to us. Might be, no, will be. It will be given to us. Will be given to us. Well, I've been asking, prophet, and I still don't have what I've been asking for. Well, what's going on, prophet? Let's look at James 4 and 3. There's two reasons James outlines we don't have when we ask God for something in our secret places with him. We have not, number one, because we ask not. But then number two, when we do ask, we ask with selfish motives. My God, my God, my God. We're going to just keep on flowing here. It says we ask with selfish motives so that we might consume what we get to satisfy our own lusts. One version says that we might consume what we get for our own selfish desires. How many of you know pride is an area that we cannot and we shall not bring into our secret places with God? God does not accept it. He does not even respond to it. He don't even respond when we come to him in pride. So in this secret place, God, if you're taking notes, and I trust that you are, God does not grant selfish requests. He just don't do it. And I can't apologize on behalf of the Almighty. I can't do it. Because when you look at God, you have to understand why you are asking God for what you're asking him for. You have to know this, saints. You have not because you ask not, and then we get bold enough to ask, but then we ask so that what we get, we can please our own selfish desires. That's pride, and God does not operate according to the spirit of pride. So 1 Kings 3, Solomon asked for wisdom. Why? So that he could govern God's people. Do you see the connection? He didn't say, I want wisdom so that they can pat me on the back and talk about how high and mighty and how awesome of a man of God I am. No, so I want wisdom so that they can blast my name over the intercom. No, somebody chat with me. No, that's not God. God says to Solomon, since you are willing to help me and my people, Solomon, I'll do what you've asked, and I'll give you wealth and honor in addition to wisdom. And so you look at how God just moved over Solomon's life. So the question I want to impose to you on today, when you say, prophet, I've been praying and I've been asking and I've been seeking God, why don't I have, you fill in the blank, why don't I have it yet? My question is, why are you asking God for what you're asking him for? Amen. He knows our motives. He knows our heart. Let me say this. In the secret places with God, that's one place you cannot hide the truth. My God, my God. You cannot act and say one thing and in your heart mean another thing. My God, my God. God does not operate like that. He judges the motives of our heart. So our hearts have to be right. That's why we spent so many days repenting and need to spend several more days continuing in the spirit of repentance every day that we fall short of the glory of God and his will for our life. But let's look at Hannah. Hannah was barren. She couldn't have any children to save her life. She could not conceive. She couldn't have any children. So Peninnah was found with many children, okay? And she also was found provoking Hannah. And y'all know that was wrong. Hannah can't have kids. Peninnah having all these kids and got the nerve to be provoking Hannah. So have you ever seen folk who just want to flaunt their stuff around you? You know, big show off? Sure you have. Sure you have. You know, just want to show off what they have. So Hannah said, I'm going to fix you. She said, I'm going to fix you. You watch this. Hannah obviously knew what makes God respond. And in 1 Samuel 1 and 11, Hannah actually says, Lord, if you remember me and not forget your servant to give me a son, I will give him back to you. Come on, y'all. You know the story. Hannah birthed and dedicated her son Samuel back unto the Lord, and he became a great prophet of the Lord. It's like, who's walking in favor now, Peninnah? Okay? So Hannah, just like Solomon, she said, Lord, I don't want this son just to say to Peninnah, aha, I got a son too. No, I want a son so that I, God, can dedicate him back to you. He will be a great man of God, and he will be an oracle. He will be a voice, God, that will speak for you in the earth realm. That is the way God honored Hannah's request. So I say that because it does not matter what it looks like other people around you have. It don't matter. You got to catch this in the spirit. Catch this in the spirit of this teaching. Some of you have been without for so long that you thought you were actually outside of the will of God. Well, let me just bring some clarity to it, okay? God's just waiting for you to get your priorities right. Some of y'all are thinking, whoa, prophet, that is hard. That's a big pill to swallow. How can you even articulate that? You know, you're talking about, you know, you see me an apostle and everything just looks so easy. But you're talking about, we're 50, 51, you know, years old. And you're talking about having tapped into the will of God for me at 14 years old. You do the math. I have learned what to do. I've learned what not to do. You hear? I have learned what gets God's attention, and through revelation, I have learned what does not get his attention, okay? And when our priorities are not right, then we don't get God's attention at all. When he gives what you're asking, can you guarantee that he get the recognition, the praise, the honor, and the glory? Somebody going, oh yeah, prophet, that's easy. I'll chat, I'll Facebook. Look what God has done. I'll even testify in church. Let me tell y'all what the Lord has done. Okay, you check that box. Praise the Lord. Holy Spirit has a few more questions. Can you guarantee that what he blesses you with will not get in the way of you spending quality time with him? Ouch. Ouch. How many times have you seen people be blessed with the things of God, and now all of a sudden, I ain't got no time to spend quality time with God? Secret place? What's that? Quality time with God? What's that? I'm too busy. What? Enjoying what I have or working to keep what I have? God blessed me with it, and I got to work myself crazy, work myself on Sundays, work myself to death. And I can't even rehearse the word, and it's on internet church. I can't even hit the replay button. So can you guarantee that it won't get in the way of your quality time with God? Somebody said yes. Some folks said, oops, ouch. Holy Spirit says, can you guarantee that it will not prevent you from worshiping him? Not just worshiping him, but fellowshipping with the saints. Because fellowship is critical. So many people tap into the blessings of the Lord, and then they forget all about him and fellowshipping with his people who build them up in their faith. And so they start associating with prideful people. Therefore, they become prideful themselves, okay? As if they have all that they have because of some great thing that they have done. I don't know what gets into the mind of these prideful people. It's like, it's all of a sudden, it's like, hey, I got all of this because I worked hard. Because I did overtime, because I was deserving. No, baby, let me say this. None of us are deserving of anything. It was God's unmerited favor. It was his grace. It was his mercy. Come on. That allowed these blessings to overshadow and overtake us. And God gets the glory. And it will not stop us from worshiping him and praising him and fellowshipping with those who he has assigned to build us up in our faith. So ask yourself, why do you want what you are asking God for? So in this secret place, God examines our heart, and he knows our motive and intent for everything. Can y'all chat that, please? Everything. We can't hide anything from God. In this secret place, I asked God for a husband. Y'all know the story. You know the tall, dark, handsome husband. But I had to add a piece onto that. just to make sure that I would get this husband, watch this, y'all, sooner, than later. I said, so that we would co-labor in ministry together. Now, God knew that I was not fronting. He knew I was not, y'all heard the saying, faking the funk? He knew I was not faking. He knew I was serious about this thing. And I said, God, if you're going to send him so we can co-labor in ministry together. And he did it because I had to tack the part on that brings glory and honor back to him. And so I recall asking God for two sons, and people were like, why two sons? Is that just for you? Just because you don't want to do hair? Is it because you don't want to fool with makeup? And no, it was bigger than that. I said, God, you grant me with two sons, and we will raise them to be head of households, and they will lead their family in the word of God. And so to this day, John and Jeremiah are both serving the Lord. They're both aiding in the vision God has given Apostle and myself with RCC. They're both, faithful in their giving. Come on, y'all. We got people who COVID-19 that just knocked them off the stool of giving, knocked them right off of the path of righteousness where they're giving and setting themselves up to be blessed so that they can bless other people, just falling wayward everywhere you look. And so through it all, they're still consistent in their tithing and their giving back to the Lord. And so you have to make sure that whatever you're asking God for in your secret place, you can't hide. You can throw the prayer shawl over your head all you want. But when God looks down from his throne, he sees your heart. And the question is, what are your motives and what is your intent? Amen. Amen. So once again, why do you want what you're asking God for in this secret place? So in the secret place, we ask and we shall receive. It's a place where we seek and we shall find what we're looking for plus some extra. That's exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask, think, or imagine. God, we serve. We're asking one thing in a secret place. God, just give me wisdom. And we end up getting wealth and everything else that comes with it, okay? But God does that because what we're asking him for is to bring him glory. So just like Solomon, when he made a ruling, some of you recall him making a ruling to cut the baby in half, to determine who the baby's real mother is, okay? There was a debate between who the real mother was, and Solomon said, tell you what, we're gonna cut the baby in half. And all of Israel was astonished by his ruling because there was no king to be compared to Solomon. He knew that if he threatened to cut this baby in half, you better believe one mama gonna be like, cut the baby, cause I ain't birthed the baby. But the other mama gonna be like, no, don't cut the baby. And he knew then at that point who the real mother was. So he astonished the people. And so what you do in your secret time and the wisdom that God downloads to you, man, people don't know how we get what we get, how we do what we do. They don't know how we know what we know. But it's because we have abided. We have remained in our secret place with God. So this secret place with God, yes, sir, yes, ma'am, it will cause us to stand out. You want to stand out in public? You spend quality time with God in the secret place. And that's a 24/7 place with God. Or at the water, in the house, on the job, in the church, in the car, wherever you are. You invoke the presence of the Lord and you just remain in his presence, even coming out of the 10 days of awe. Amen. Somebody just chat with me. Glory to God. Glory to God. Go ahead and chat that in the room. So we astonish people because they don't know how we can do what we do and why we know what we know. They just don't know. But the answer is because we seek God in our secret place. Divine wisdom, knowledge, and revelation are more than just words. Do you hear what I'm saying? They are more than just words. Catch it in the spirit. Lord, give me wisdom, knowledge, and revelation. They are more than words. People come to you and they come to me because we stand out. We stand out. You know, we still seem to actually care for people. We care for them. That was in part of Apostles' instructions of the New Era Church. We build up the community. You, as whether you are saved or unsaved, it don't matter. You're a part of the mankind, the race that God created. We're going to build you up and love you. Come on, y'all, in spite of. And guess what? We're going to be crazy enough to believe that the love of God that we share with you is going to be enough to compel you to a relationship with him. And so we care for people. So let's seek God's wisdom to benefit others rather than ourselves. Okay, that gets God's attention. It's not about me, my four, and no more. But let's seek God's wisdom so that we can counsel and bring blessings to other people. Amen, saints. Amen. I can't hear. Amen. So we have the wisdom, knowledge, and revelation that they need because of our secret place with God. So that's why Sunday I said, you better praise God for the people who are going to reap the blessings and the benefits of us abiding in the presence of the Lord, because they're going to benefit from our time spent with God. When you have and gain access, okay? When you have and you access this secret place, you understand that the church building is not the only place where the prophetic anointing is flowing. Y'all hear me? You hear me? You understand that this prophetic and apostolic, this New Testament church grace and anointing is bigger than the four walls of the church. When you have and access the secret place, you understand Matthew 16 and 19. Let's look at it. It says, I will give you keys to the kingdom. So he's given us access to his thoughts, his ways. We are kingdom-minded citizens. We got keys, y'all. That's our secret place gives us access, okay, to the secret things of God. We got keys to go in any room and unlock that which has been locked and held back from not only us, but the people of God. So when we see or sense something is not right, we have power and authority to bind and loose on earth through the prophetic, and heaven backs us. Heaven backs us. You know how you're going on a fight and you like, look, we're gonna handle things after school today. You got my back, and you got a whole entourage of people who got your back. Well, when we bind and loose things on earth, the enemy is gonna try to block what it is that we are binding and what it is we are loosing. But the word said, heaven got our back. Heaven said, go ahead, do it. I got your back. And the one thing Satan cannot come up against is heaven itself. It's God himself, okay? And so in this secret place, we knock at the door of God's heart, okay? And just like any other father who sees his child on the other side of the door knocking, okay? When the father has everything he needs, everything the child wants and desires, come on, the father has it. The father graciously opens the door of opportunity and provisions to make sure that we have all we need to fulfill his will for our life. Let's look at Psalm 37, 25. It says, I once was young and now I'm old. But, somebody say, but. This is one place where but comes into play. I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread. Come on, that's a profound scripture. If we ever find ourselves knocking and we banging and we trying to get in, but the door is not opening, could it be that when he opened the door of opportunity and gave us everything we needed, the provision that we needed, could it be that when he did it the first time, we murmured and complained? I don't know about you, but my mama used to say, you so ungrateful, next time you ask me, I ain't gonna give you nothing. You see what I'm saying? Come on, y'all. God, we knocking, banging, asking, but no doors opening. What? How did you handle the first provision or the first blessing that God bestowed upon you? Murmuring and complaining, the children of Israel. They were found murmuring and complaining for 40 years. When God instructed them to continue my will, I have a promised land for you. And it's not just the milk, the substance, and the things you need. He says to them, it's honey. There's honey in this land, the sweet stuff, the things you want, long for, and desire. Y'all know I'm a believer of that promised land experience, and it was not just for Caleb and Joshua and the generation that entered therein. That promised land is for you, and that promised land is for me. But we have to make sure while we're knocking, when God opens up this door, that we are appreciative and we're not murmuring and complaining. It ain't enough. It's not the right size. It's not the right fit. No, we appreciate what God has blessed us with, and we continue to live in faith. Could it be that some under the sound of my voice are still knocking because when he opened the door of provision the first time, you mismanaged the resources that he provided for your vision? He blessed you with it, and you blink your eyes, and as a result of mismanagement, the resources are nowhere to be found. So here you go knocking again, and God is going, you're not a good steward. I tried. I gave it to you. It's nowhere to be found anymore. What happened to it? What happened to it? It was spent on your own selfish desires. And that does not move God to continue to bless you and give you the finest blessings that he has in store for you. So Father, forgive us. Okay, come on, y'all. Forgive us, forgive us. God is sitting on his throne, and I heard him clear as day today. He said, I'm not holding anybody up. You holding yourself up. So the mismanagement of funds, the mismanagement of resources that he provided were eaten. They were enjoyed. They were not used to do what you said you were going to do with it in the secret place with God. Go ahead and repent and say, Lord, forgive me, and believe that he will now open up new doors of opportunity and provision for you. Amen. Amen, y'all. Glory to God. Let's look at another reference of the secret place. In Matthew 6:6, the word says, and when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogue and on the street corners to be seen by others. That's a mouthful right there. Okay, why are we praying? Why are we praying where we're praying at, okay? Is it that we want them to hear how articulate we are in our speech? You know, no, let's keep reading the scripture. It says, truly I tell you, those people have received their reward already in full. They just want to be seen of men. They want men to know they can pray, they can fast. So we tell you, oh, no, it's not necessary. Rather, when you pray, go into your room. Close the door, pray to your Father who is unseen or in heaven. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret, in your secret place. Come on, in secret, in your secret place, he will reward you openly. Come on. That's why you can't tell everyone what you're praying, decreeing, and believing God for. You can't do it. He said, come out from the public setting, all loud, obnoxious, out of order with your prayers, just telling everybody everything. And you can't do that. Some things are specifically only for the Father to hear in your secret place. You know, and in the heavenly language, let's not even talk about that. Entering into our heavenly language where we don't even... Half the time we start in the English and we shift into our heavenly language. And not only do we not always understand exactly what we're saying, but saints, Satan surely don't understand what you're saying. Satan cannot comprehend or understand the words that you are praying. Come on, y'all. Who knows what we're praying when we're in our secret place, releasing our secret language, Holy Spirit? God himself. So I encourage you to enter into that secret place with God and in your secret language, your heavenly language, heavenly place, heavenly language, secret place, secret language, wherever you are, you know, don't think that you can't enter in and abide in this secret place in your car while you're walking from your car to your job. What are you saying? What are you communicating to God during that time? You all know that we're entering into public arenas now, and we're entering into tremendous danger. There's tremendous danger, danger seen and unseen. Some things we know going on in there that's not right. Other things we don't even know. So I encourage you, wherever you are, to remain in this secret place with God, because we cannot afford to open the door to the opposing forces. Okay? So when he says in that word, go into your room and shut the door, y'all thinking a physical door. God is bigger than a physical door. You know, I told y'all, I think the women, I shared with them, man, when I was young in the faith, I used to, you know, rush home and slam the door open and run to my closet and drop down on the floor and, you know, try to keep up with what it was that I was feeling in the car. And Holy Spirit is telling me now, why didn't I just tap into what he was saying and doing in my car? Why not just pull over and park? And go into that, ooh, that intimate place with God and get it while the getting was good. Why did I feel like I had to go into a closet and shut the door? God is bigger than a door. So when you shut the door, Holy Spirit showed me today, he's a prophet telling me, shut the door of doubt. Shut the door of competition. Shut the door of jealousy. Shut the door when you go in to pray in your secret place, because God says in his word, I'm a jealous God. He said, I'm not going to compete with anybody. I'm not going to compete with anything. You coming in my presence with competition, doubt, and jealousy, there's no faith anywhere to be found. He's like, come back to me when you got some faith and when you shut the door to these opposing contrary forces of the enemy. Shut the door, saints. We got to shut the door. We got to shut the door to the voice of the enemy who constantly speaks in our mind. I told you at the water, God says, prophet, they on you, and he stays on you because you are making a tremendous impact in every life that you touch. Once I touch you, you touch others, and the enemy don't want that. So, saints, shut the door. Satan just knows what a tremendous gift you are to the body of Christ. Satan just knows the dynamic, miraculous impact that you're going to have in the lives of those that you come in contact with. So when you're in the presence of the Lord, shut the door to the haters, the naysayers, and just allow God to speak to you one-on-one. He says, shut the door, just you and him. So being alone should not make you feel lonely. Okay, let me say that again. Being alone should not make you feel lonely. I'm so lonely during this COVID-19. Honey, we going on 2 years. Okay? And what has happened with the people who have shipped into feeling lonely is that was just an open door. Come on, y'all. Better stop playing with me. Stop it. That loneliness was an open door to what, prophet? Depression. Depression. Separation. Separation. It's an open door for the enemy to come in and cause depression. So you have to transform your mind to the place where alone time is quality time with God in your secret place. Amen. And so Matthew 6:6 goes on to say, your Father who sees and hears in secret will reward you openly. So I want to speak this into your spirits tonight. Get ready, get ready, get ready for open, exposed blessings to come your way. The prayers that you have submitted to God have not and will not go unanswered. He hears and he sees what you do and say in private, and by the power of God's word, he says, get ready for me to release blessings on you publicly that will astonish and amaze all of those that come into your contact. He said, let you know that he's going to reward you openly, and not just openly, but publicly. And those who thought that you couldn't do it, they're going to be put to shame. Those who are watching you in disbelief, they're going to be amazed. He said, those who are talking about you behind your back, he says, their words will be cut off and silenced. Their words will be cut off and silenced. They won't know what to say when they see God publicly and openly bestow his blessings, his grace, his favor upon your life. Glory to God. Glory to God, saints. Well, saints, I know we have had a tremendous time together. I pray to God that you all are eating that word up, and that you will do something different. I pray and decree and believe that you will alter and adjust your ways, your mindset, your attitude, your intents on and your motives for a thing. I pray to God that your eyes have been opened tonight, and you now see that God wants to honor you. He wants to bless you. He wants to release unto you all of his greatest blessings and promises. He's not holding us up. We have a tendency to holding ourselves up. And as I close, I want to close us with Psalm 32 and 7. In the word of the Lord, David says, you, Lord, are my hiding place. Receive that in the spirit. Just lift your hands all over this place, wherever you are, and decree this with me. You, Lord, are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit wants you to be reminded that in this secret place with God, you have to know how to make a sound and sing a song of deliverance. Yes, Holy Spirit. Yes, Holy Spirit. Oh my God, you gotta know how to wage war on the enemy. You gotta know how and when to shift out of the natural into the supernatural spirits of God. Because you're not supposed to be praising God when all hell is breaking loose around you. Satan said you ain't supposed to be praising God. But glory be to God. We know that our praise, our song of deliverance, it will set the captives free. It will break the chains. It will loose the shackles and set us free in Jesus' name. So, yes, when you're in your secret place, you may be worshiping and you may be praying. You may be listening. You may be asking. You may, whatever you do, but whatever you do, don't forsake the sound and the song of deliverance. Hallelujah. There's a sound in our secret place that will loose shackles and bring deliverance to our mind. Y'all stop playing with me, but more importantly, stop playing with the enemy. Stop playing with the enemy of your mind. Stop entertaining the work of this. Stop entertaining the words of the enemy. Stop being tempted and enticed by Satan. You gotta put brakes on him. When you remain and abide in his secret place with God, you know when it's not God. You know when it's an attack and an attempt from the enemy. And you don't give him not 1 second to come in and to claim territory that don't belong to him. You got to get serious about being in your secret place with God. The secret place is not a place of failure or defeat. No, it is not. The secret place is a place of victory, where we are continuously breaking ungodly thoughts. We're continuously breaking unhealthy emotions and feelings. Somebody in internet church, please chat with me and lay hands on your heart and say, I break unhealthy emotions and feelings. I break. Chat this with me so I can see who is out here with me today. Chat, I break ungodly thoughts. Can you chat with me? I break unproductive time. I break unproductive time. And I remain, I abide up under the blood of Jesus. When we see Paul and Silas, they were praying. Yes, they were. They were in a secret place. Yes, they were. You know the word. Paul and Silas prayed, but what else did they do? What else did they do, saints? They sang hymns. I dare to say that Paul and Silas were in their secret place praying to God, and glory to God, they broke out into a song of deliverance right there in the prison, right there in the jail. They tapped into their secret place with God, and the word of the Lord says, Suddenly there was a great earthquake. You better get ready because something's about to move. Something's about to shake. Something's about to break off of your life. Something's about to break off of your mind. Because when you release your song of deliverance unto the Lord, it says that there was a great earthquake so that the foundation of the prison walls were shaken. It doesn't matter who in your family member, in your family or your lineage, it don't matter what type of corrupt foundation they laid. It doesn't matter what corrupt foundation was laid. It don't matter what generational curse you were birthed up under. But the song of deliverance, hallelujah, in your secret place will break the chains and it will loose the shackles, because suddenly the foundation of the prison walls were shaken and immediately the doors were open and everyone's chains fell off. I speak that word into your spirit on today. Get into your secret place. This is not, it's like the 10 days of prayer and consecration. Just because I conclude the secret place teaching, it does not conclude your determination from abiding under the shadow of the Almighty and remaining in the secret place with God. 24/7, wherever you go, whatever you do, you are in the secret place of God. So we bless God. Hallelujah. Can you praise God with me on this evening? We bless you, God. We glorify you. We honor you and we thank you, Lord, for a word that will resonate. It will not be an ending to this secret place teaching, but it's a word that will resonate in our spirit, a word that will transform our mind, a word that will cause a greater sense of determination for us to rest, rule, and abide in your secret place and your presence 24/7. In Jesus' name, we say it on one accord. Amen and amen. I would love to hear from you all out there in the internet church. I love you. I bless you. We're going to go ahead and release now a few ministry updates prior to logging off of the internet church service, Our Power tonight. We do want to remind you that registration is currently underway for approximately 10 students to attend my Chain Breakers Deliverance Ministry class. That's going to be coming up starting Wednesday, October the 6th, going through Wednesday, November the 3rd at 7 p.m. In this New Testament church, let me remind you, it is okay, because though Our Power will continue to be recorded, you can come to Chain Breakers at 7 and you can rehearse the Our Power on Thursday on your way to work or while you're at work. And so we're doing a new thing. We're not in bondage to religion where everybody got to be in one place at one time. Mm-mm. Those days are gone. They are gone. So I do ask that you would call Elder Brenda at the executive office or Elder Kim, 8200717. Please register by September the 26th. Also, the cost is $10 for your deliverance manual. It's a book by Fred and Ida May Hammond. And then we'll do shipping and handling, of course, for you to have the book mailed. If you want to secure the manual on your own through Amazon, you're more than welcome to just call the executive office and get the title and the author of the book once again. We do want to encourage everyone under the sound of my voice to register for MSG, Apostolic and Prophetic Training. We were on with Apostle Zen last night, and he's just on fire. He's on fire for our November class that's coming up. And so we do ask that you would check your e-blast for the registration link, or go to the Facebook wall and you will find the link there as well. And if push come to shove and you still can't seem to get it where you need it to be to register, our point of contact is Minister Mia Ferdinand, and you can reach her at wow@rccva.church. Or you can call the executive office as well. Amen. And so we bless God for you at this time. We're going to prepare for the release of our tithe, offering, and sacrificial seeds, multiple ways to give. You know the ways. If you're on the internet church, you can click the donate button. Go ahead and release at that time. We commend you for your faithfulness in giving. Many of you may or may not have been updated by Apostle or myself, but yes, we are still closing on the building. Delayed does not mean denied, and you better believe the very day that the closing actually occurs, you will know. And we are believing God. If you are a prayer warrior, believe with us. It will be in the month of September in Jesus' name. Put a seal on it in Jesus' name. So if we can all just go in our secret place even now and decree that with us. We believe there's power in agreement. So please, let's continue to remain faithful in giving. You can text your amount and your code to 84321. And you can also mail or drop off your contribution to the executive office. If you can't mail or drop it off, Elder Brenda is available for a phone call at 820-0717. And just call in your contribution. She can process it online, and you'll still receive account for your contribution will still be accounted for. So on behalf of Apostle Charlie and myself, once again, it has been, of course, always extreme joy to just be used of the Lord and to just speak the voice of the Lord directly from his throne.